truly amazing. His goodness and his mercy endures forever, and we are so grateful to him for his goodness and for his mercy. And you are invited, Holy Spirit, to come into this tabernacle that we may worship you in spirit and in truth, and to give thanksgiving for him keeping us to this very moment. God is just awesome. Y'all know that. Amen. Amen. Thank you, choir. Thank you for the great job that you do in bringing the church into worship and song. And we just praise God this morning. Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we are so grateful to you for this time, this opportunity once again, just to share a word with your people, to share this time, O Heavenly Father, that we may worship you and give thanks to you for keeping us throughout all that we have seen, that we have faced, regardless as to what it might have been. You are still the King, and you're invited to come in and to occupy our minds, our souls, our bodies, that we might continue just to lift up the cross of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Now, Heavenly Father, it's another time, it's another opportunity that you've granted this, your servant, to speak unto these, thy people. And for that, we are grateful, O Heavenly Father. Hide now this, your servant, once again, behind the cross, that those who are here might see thee and not me. Let the words of my mouth, the meditations of my heart, be acceptable in thy sight, you who are our strength and our Redeemer. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, we ask it all in his holy name. Amen. For those of you who have your Bibles, and I won't be here long, but I just want to share a word with you this morning, which is very familiar to the majority of us who sit here in the audience this morning, and those of you who are listening by any medium that we have that is going forth to the rest of this world. I ask you to find in your Bible the Gospel of St. John, the 3rd chapter, and most of you will quote it verbatim, John 3:16. Y'all know that one, don't you? Amen. We see it flashed on poster board and everything at football and baseball and basketball and soccer. That's becoming popular now in the United States of America. And is there anything else that I haven't mentioned with that is popular as far as sports are concerned? I covered all the four basics now, right? Football, basketball, baseball, and soccer. You see it in the crowd. You see people hold up their plaques. John 3:16. A lot of folk in those crowds don't even know what John 3:16 is. The majority, I would say, in most crowds do not know what that represents. Some people have even think or take it to be an alcoholic beverage, but it's not. John 3:16, and for those who are listening out there today who might not be in the sanctuary, if you're not here, I want you to understand what John 3:16 is. And if by chance someone just might have stumbled across our service this morning, I want you to know what it's all about. For the love of God, that's the topic this morning. For the love of God. Love, the word love, is mentioned so many times throughout Scripture, from old all the way into New Testament. It is so amazing. All that God did was out of love. Do you realize that the creation, when God stepped out on nothing and said, let there be, and there was, God spoke out of love. He spoke out of compassion. He spoke into existence everything that we see surrounding us in our day and time, the hills, the valleys, the flowers, the trees, the oceans, the rivers, the creeks. All that we see, God spoke into existence. He even spoke animal life. If you go back to Genesis, the very beginning, the book that gives us reference as to what God did, there is something unique and there's something blessed about what God did. God spoke all of that into existence. And then after he had created and he had spoke into existence, the animal life and everything, God stopped at that point, and I think it was the sixth day of creation. And James Weldon Johnson says something in a poem, The Creation, that I find fascinating, and I've always admired his works. He said, God stooped down in the dust of the earth, and like a mama bending down over her baby, he fashioned out of that dust a man, and he breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. And he says, man became a living soul. I think that is the most unique illustration of the creation of man, who we actually are. But in the love that God did in creation of man and woman were created as sinless beings at the very beginning. You following me this morning? I just want y'all to follow me just for a few moments for the love of God. But before he breathed into the nostrils the breath of life of man, God had already had a solution to the problem, if the problem occurred, and God in his foreknowledge knew that a problem would occur and man would go against his holy and divine will. And you know the reason why I know that, and some of you may speculate on that, but I want to clear your minds. When you get over to the book of the Revelation, and John is given a revelation of what will be at the end when we all give an account for the deeds that are done in these bodies, John sees a vision and he says, behold, the Lamb of God that was slain before the foundations of the earth. So before there was a when or where, before God said, let there be and there was, before God fashioned man, before God spoke into the existence of the trees out there and the rivers and the streams, God already had a solution to the problem of sin. And see, it's so complicated for some folk to realize that God has a solution to the problem. There is a solution for all of the bickering and the disagreements and the things that are going on in our world today, the different divisive things that are being taught and preached in this day and time by evangelists as well as those who don't know Christ. There's a solution for God. Look at it. It's in there this morning. John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. That's a beautiful, and you know what? There are those who say, I just don't understand the word when I study it. I don't understand the script. But there's enough understanding right there. One verse. if you just meditate on it, if you just believe it in your heart, if you trust in God, if you believe in the love of the Son of Almighty God, if you believe that his blood covers us from all of our sins, if you believe that he died that we might live, salvation is right there wrapped up in that verse. And in all of our hard-headedness, in all of our craziness, because all of us got some crazy. Y'all know that. We all do. I don't ask anymore which side of the family crazy comes on. I just say, where's the crazy in your family? On left or right? Is it mom's side, dad? No, it's on both sides. It's in somebody. It's in your family. And as intelligent as I think that most of us try and be, that craziness comes out. Some of us got some cousins, don't we? Hello, somebody. Y'all got them in your family. And you know, they're those that, and I say this with all compassion and love and understanding. You out in public somewhere and you see that crazy cousin and you try to get away and they'll let you get way over there. They'll be way over here. And you know what they're going to holler? Hey, cuz! Yeah. And don't ignore them. Just go ahead and claim them because of the fact you know that they're in your family. So embrace them and teach them the love of God. Teach them John 3:16. Teach them that God loves them in spite of what they have done or what they've said. Well, I wanted to go to this verse this morning, so, and I know it's such a plain verse for understanding of all of us, but I want us to dig deeper into this verse just a little bit to see some things. The love of God actually constrains us also. Do you understand what I'm saying? Here's what I'm saying. It takes control over our lives. The things that when we come to the knowledge of Christ and we have accepted him as our Lord and Savior, when we have confessed him in baptism and become the members of the body of Christ, what that love does, it makes us look at things a whole lot different than the way that we used to look at them. It makes us treat people in a different way than what we used to treat them. It makes us understand that we all have issues as far as life is concerned. But in our issues, we have found salvation through and by the Son of God, the only begotten of the Father, the one who bled and died for my sins and yours, that we might have that right to the tree of life. What I just, for the love of God, it constrains us. And then we are taught throughout the scriptures from Old into New Testament, we're taught some things as far as the Word of God is concerned. We're taught how the relationship can build between us and our Savior. We're taught as to how it can be developed. You don't believe me? Go back and study the Psalms. Not all of them are written by David, but the ones that are written by David, it tells us of the love of God. Even when David sinned in Psalm, and he goes, and you go to Psalm 51, yes, he says, it's against thee and thee only have I sinned and done this in thy sight. And he says, restore unto me the joy of thy salvation. See, when you sin, you are outside of the will of God and you don't feel like you're saved anymore. And that's the reason why David says, restore the joy. I get joy in knowing that I am saved. Do you understand that? But there are times when I've walked out of his will, I didn't feel saved. I didn't feel sanctified. I didn't feel anything on the inside. And I had to pray and ask God to restore unto me the joy that I once had. See that, and I'm just thankful that this joy that I have, the world didn't give that to me. And being that the world didn't give it, the world cannot take that away from me. That's one thing I'm thankful for. And I'm thankful that God didn't stop with David. God showed mercy unto those who came after that. He showed mercy to Solomon. He showed mercy and grace to the prophets. He showed mercy and grace to Elijah, to Jeremiah. He showed mercy to those who came after him. Because there were times that Israel went so deep in sin till it seemed like God was going to give up, but he made a promise. And his promise was to his servant, David. And being that he made that promise, God will fulfill every single promise that he makes. If it ain't but a remnant, as the Bible says, and that remnant means just a few. If there ain't but just a few, it seems like the world went crazy, but I'm here to tell you there's just a few who still believe in the goodness of God. It seems like everything's going haywire, but there are few that still call upon the name of the Lord. It seems like everybody's in disagreement, politics as to where one side can't get along with the other, but I'm here to tell you there are just a few who are believing God and saying, we're going to trust in the Lord. We're going to wait to see what God will do. Because we believe God's going to bring it out. He's going to make a way out of no way. He's going to set our feet upon a solid rock. And he's going to tell us, run on just a little while longer. That's what he's going to do. Well, I get excited about this scripture also because of the fact when the church got out of order, way back in the New Testament age, Paul had to address the issue. So I come up to 1 Corinthians 13. And I want you to know that 1 Corinthians 13, Paul had to address the issue as far as love in the church was concerned. Because you see, Corinth had a whole lot of problems, and the New Testament church had a whole lot of issues. And it's just like in this day and time, church got issues, y'all. Not everybody's preaching the same thing. Church got issues, y'all. Not everybody is teaching on Christ, the solid rock I stand. All of the ground is sinking sand. The church got issues, y'all, as to where there are those who say that we're crazy because we worship the way that we do, because we get loud as far as our worship is concerned. But I believe you ought to praise God. As for what the psalmist says, in tremble and in dance. I think that you ought to, every now and then, the spirit ought to hit you, whether it's in your home, whether it's in the building, whether it's on your job, whether it's at work, whether it's in the school or where. Every now and then, something ought to move you on the inside. And if you can't do nothing else, just dance for it. Because that's how good God has been. And I want you to understand that even in this crisis period of time, even when we lose loved ones, I want you to understand that's a reason still to praise God. Why? Because if they knew the Lord, I ain't worried about them. They're in a better place than what I am right now. Absent from the body, present with the Lord. That's what I believe. And we're going to join them one day. But 1 Corinthians 13, when they got in trouble as far as the church was concerned, Paul had to address them and let them know, though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, and I don't love, hello, something wrong. It don't profit me anything. Though I have the gift of prophecy, I have all knowledge that I can reveal things to you, but I don't love, I ain't nothing, y'all. And if I'm that charitable guy where I give away everything that I own and it feeds the poor, but I have not loved, I ain't nothing. In other words, what Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians, because of the fact there were those inside of the church that had built themselves up to be holier than others. There was a group who spoke in tongues. Hello, somebody. And they thought they were holy, but they needed an interpreter to interpret what was being said. So they hadn't even volunteered to see if anybody had been given the gift of interpretation inside of the church. And then there were those who thought they could prophesy, and they were prophelying. Hello, somebody. Prophelying. And Paul said, even though you think you got that gift of prophecy and you can foretell the future, he said, but you don't love in what you're doing. You're not doing that in love. He said, it don't profit you anything. And then there was the charitable group. They just gave and gave, and they were given to this organization. They were given to another. They were feeding the poor, and they were doing this and doing that. And they thought because of their gift of giving, it was holy unto the Lord. Paul said, you ain't doing that out of pure love. So I want you to understand where you are. That this thing is serious about following the Lord. It's serious about your commitment to God. It's serious because of the fact the only way that the world outside sees anything about Christ in us is the way you walk, the way you talk, the way you live. It's because of the love of God in us. God so loved the world. But even before Adam and Eve stepped foot on this planet, he had given his only, that boggles your mind, and some of y'all gonna call me and say, how is that so? I may not understand it fully, and I'm gonna have a debate with somebody about it, I know. But God is so good that I believe it by faith. And you know what the Bible tells me about that? Faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of what I can't even see. It might not be all revealed in this. And Paul says that in 1 Corinthians 13, when you get to the end. We see through a glass dimly. But then face to face, one of these days, I know in part. I might prophesy in part, but when that which is perfect is come, Jesus, when he comes back for his church, all of this in part is going to be done away with. Do you hear me? Amen, lights. Do you hear me? Yeah. Amen, somebody. Do you hear me? Let the church say, amen. We believe you, Lord, and we've trusted you at your word. This morning, if there's anyone who's watching, if there's anyone who's inside of the sanctuary and you don't have a church home, I want you to know how much God loves you, and you will be accepted into the body of Christ by letter, Christian experience, by candidate for baptism. As the choir sings, you're welcome to come down. Come on, baby. May we stand as the invitation is extended.
It's not.
into the course of this week, I pray that God will place someone in your path that you might witness to, of letting them know that Christ is the only means of salvation. Let us look to the Lord to be dismissed, and our ushers will then take charge of the exit of all of you from the building. Now may the blessings of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the fellowship of God, and the sweet communion of His Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide with each of us now, henceforth, and forevermore, as we all sing together.
Our deepest sympathies and prayers are extended to our LPMBC Church family who have lost loved ones over the course of the week. Please pray for Sister Kim Cox in the loss of her brother, Sister Maxine Gilmore in the loss of her brother, Sister Deborah Carter Bell in the loss of her sister, Sister Tamara Watkins in the loss of her aunt. Also pray for Reverend Taylor Stokes in the loss of his aunt and cousin. Condolences to the family of Sister Karen Howard, who recently passed away. Howard's funeral will be this Wednesday, January 12th, at Lake Providence.
Hello, everyone. I'm David Goins, and these are your announcements. The Youth Education and Career Ministry presents a Summer Jobs Workshop on February 19, 2022. Join us to learn about summer jobs, networking, and much more. There will be an iPad giveaway and other prizes. You must be present to win. Look for more details to come. Lake Providence Missionary Baptist Church will host a free 2022 ACT Prep Workshop. Sessions will be held January 8th, 15th, 22nd, and 29th. A free mock test will take place February 5th. The workshops are open to the community. The ACT test is February 12th. You must register on the actstudent.org website. Lake Providence Missionary Baptist Church Partner School, Paragon Mills, is in need of math lab volunteers for the next semester during the hours of 10 a.m. to 2:30 p.m. School officials are requesting just an hour of your time to help out where help is needed. Please contact the church office with your information if you are able to assist with this need in our community. Lake Providence has made it easy for you to give online. Simply download the Vanco Mobile Faith Engagement app or go to our website, lpmbc.org, and click the Give Online tab. You can join us for Bible study and Sunday school classes online. Details can be found on the Lake Providence website. Join us for events, sessions, seminars, and more online. Health and wellness, life and home. Visit lpmbc.org for more details. Also join us for prayer online. Renew and refresh as we gather together to pray. Those are your announcements for this week. I'm David Goins. Have a blessed week, and remember, here at Lake Providence, we're changing lives with the unchanging word.